Hello, my friends, and welcome to a $500 gaming PC tutorial. Now, this is something that I used to do a lot, and if you're a longtime subscriber to the channel, thank you. But also, if you're not, this is a way where I can kind of show you some of the best deals on gaming PCs, but more importantly, how my thought process goes in actually picking these components, putting them together, and showing you what kind of PC you can get yourself for $500. So for this video, I'm going to be using Amazon to do all of my ordering. Mostly because not only can I put those links in the description for you, but on top of that, hopefully you have access to Amazon, unlike Micro Center, which I love, but obviously not everyone has a Micro Center. Now, since the last time I did a budget build, a lot of things have changed, mostly for the better. There are a lot of new components, like always, but importantly, the chip shortage, the GPU shortage, a lot of that has not gone, but a lot of things have returned back to normal. Which means that for $500, I'm hopeful I can actually build a pretty decent PC. I'm actually gonna do this in a different way than I normally would. I'm gonna look for graphics cards, because at $500, I should be able to afford a low-end graphics card. Now, a graphics card is typically where you wanna spend the most money. Not always, depending on what you're doing, but for a gaming PC, putting the max value on the graphics card is usually your right move. I'm probably gonna be limited to $200 at the absolute most for my GPU. Let's see what AMD options are. So this is a 6600. The problem is if I spend $250 on this, the rest of my system is gonna be just like garbage tier, which is not necessarily always a bad idea. Like I could go ultra budget on it, but the problem is with $250, I don't have to get like an incredibly cheap case, incredibly cheap board. Like it's probably not gonna be the move. Okay, how about a 6400? $144, okay. This is not a good graphics card, I will say. But I'm actually gonna leave this open just as a potential. So this initial phase is all about just finding interesting prices, anything that jumps out to me. Like, immediately, here's something that's much better. There's an MSI 6500 XT. My gut is this is the graphics card I'm gonna go with. It's actually not always incredibly easy to figure out what's best, right? Now, if you're following this tutorial, you're just gonna, you know, click on all the links in the description, easy. But when I'm actually trying to go through and do my research, I like to actually make sure that I'm trying to get the best stuff. Cause sometimes you might find a gem that's hidden, or you'll find some absolute garbage, which is a lot of what I'm seeing right now. I think I've got enough options here. I really wanna knock out the $120 580. I don't trust Azurix, and I don't want to recommend you to do the same. And then the XFX, this 6400, it's only $10 less. It's low profile, I just don't trust it. So we're just gonna knock that out too. So I've only got two graphics cards here. It's 165 and 210. $165 is probably about the right amount of money to spend on my GPU. This should be able to play at 1080p. And importantly, this won't burn my whole budget. So I can actually afford to get a somewhat decent CPU. And if I spend like $200 on this graphics card, I'm gonna have to be very conservative with the rest of my build. If you're ever in doubt, one of the things you can do, and why you need to take this with a bit of a grain of salt, is just do a search on the two graphics cards side by side. So looking at this, which is user benchmark, I don't know how much I'm gonna trust it, but looking at the 1650 versus the 6650 XT, the 6650 XT here seems like it is significantly more powerful. And mind you, I typically try to use more reputable sources like AnandTech and Tom's Hardware and whatnot, but I feel confident the 6500 XT is the move. I'm gonna add that to my cart. So, with that chosen, my next big decision is going to be on Intel versus AMD on the CPU side. This decision is kind of tricky, honestly. So one of the things I'm leaning toward would be the Core i3. Now this is 13th gen, it's gonna have great gaming performance, but where it's gonna fall a little bit flat is it's only a quad core processor. And I do think that this is gonna be a little bit limited in the long term. I'm going a little bit cheaper on my CPU than I think I could. Also partially because I just don't know what I'm gonna spend for the rest of the build. Right now though, I'm leaning toward this Ryzen 5 5500. But importantly, this is only $98. And I know that if we go with this, we can pick up a cheap AM4 motherboard for hopefully 60, 70 bucks. They'll completely do the job. And at that point, we're gonna be sitting on an actually decent budget to make sure we've got a well-rounded system. So with our CPU and our GPU in the cart, we've spent $262.99 of our $500 budget, which is actually a pretty reasonable number. I actually could have maybe spent a little bit more here, but based on the options that I've got, I feel pretty good about that. Once you've chosen your CPU, the natural next step is to choose the motherboard. Now, because we've got the 5500 in our cart, we need to pick an AM4 motherboard that's specifically going to support that. So why don't you look up AM4 motherboard. I'm gonna look for most likely an A320 because those are the cheapest, but B450 may also be the move. There's an ASRock board for 70 bucks, but it does specifically call out support for Ryzen 5000 and 5000G series. Man, do I actually do this though? 70 bucks is a really good deal. It's a super basic board, but this is a $500 system. Like, I gotta save the money when I can. We're now at $333. Still a good amount of budget. I'm not too worried. The next thing I do is go for RAM. So I should be able to easily afford 16 gigs. So I can go Corsair for $48, Silicon Power for $35. That's very cheap. It might be tempting to just grab a couple of random sticks of RAM, but I do want to at least make sure I'm buying a kit. So 16 gigs, even on a $500 system, is pretty much the minimum, right? Like, you shouldn't be buying any computer with 8 gigs of RAM in 2023. MacBook Air. I normally wouldn't recommend this, but I think I'm gonna go with the Silicon Power RAM. Maybe not the greatest decision in my life. I think it's worth making. I think this should be fine. The parts I have left are my power supply, my SSD, and my case. And with $130 to play with, I'm gonna have to go kinda cheap on my SSD. In fact, I'm actually gonna go with my SSD now. The Acclimator for $22, I'm not gonna do that. I would maybe spend a little bit more to get a brand on your SSD, especially because it's not really gonna be that much more expensive. When it comes to purchasing an SSD, 35 bucks for 500 gig is a no-brainer. If I want to go down to 250 gig, I'm only saving $6. Doesn't make sense. So 500 gig, no-brainer, add that to cart, and that puts us right over $400. Don't cheap out on your power supply, is what I normally say. Do as I say, not as I do. I'm gonna get a cheaper power supply. But I'm mostly gonna go with this one because I have bought probably a half dozen of these at this point over the years. And while they're not the most high quality supplies, importantly, they work and they don't explode. What more can you ask for, especially for 35 bucks? You know what, now that I'm actually saying it, we got $60 left. Perfect amount for actually a decent case. We can actually get a good case for 60 bucks. When it comes to picking a case, there are two main choices here. So there's a name brand case or a cheapo case. Usually the difference, in fact, exactly the difference that I've got to choose from here, is quality versus RGB. Pretty much as simple as that. I think I'm gonna recommend going with the actual name brand case. Not only because it does have the three fans, but also I trust that the build quality is gonna be better, and I trust that it's gonna be a little bit easier to build in, whereas some of the cheaper cases sometimes will have like literal like sharp edges and whatnot. It's totally up to you. There's no bad choice between these two, but for me, I'm gonna go with the Zalman. I add that to my cart, and my total is $500.32.
Wow, you went over your budget.
All right, let me go through my cart. So I've got an AMD Ryzen 5 5500. I've got an MSI Radeon RX 6500 XT, the bulk of my budget right there. The ASRock A520M HDV motherboard. Don't feel super strong about it, but I do think that is probably our best option. 16 gigs of Silicon Power DDR4, 500 gig WD Blue SSD, 500 watt thermal take power supply, and a Zalman S3 case. All right, my friends, I'm going to order these components now, and I will see you in a moment for the build and test of the Boson 5.0. All right, my friends, let us build a $500 gaming PC. Today, I'm gonna do a speed run of this thing, more so to see exactly how well it works and what kind of value you're getting for a $500 budget. Now, if you've seen any of my PC tutorials, you know that my favorite thing to do is always to open up the systems, but especially with this case, since I've never built inside of it, just to take a look and see if there's anything that jumps out. It looks very standard. Which standard is not a bad thing, right? This looks standard as in like what high-end cases are asking for nowadays. All right, let's see what is inside. Well, I will say we did choose the acrylic side panel instead of the tempered glass. Yeah, it's gonna look fine. We saved a few bucks there. But other than that, the interior of this case actually looks quite nice. So you do have a little basement where you can hide your power supply and kind of keep some cables nice and neat. We have two USB 2.0 and one USB 3. I can't really complain at this price. Maybe it would be nice to have an extra USB 3 or a USB-C, but it's fine, it's fine. So taking a closer look at the motherboard, you'll see that we've got a wide selection of IO, including
Whoa,
PS2,
is that...
VGA,
Whoa.
And HDMI, and DVI.
Wow. This was made for dinosaurs.
This is a quite low-end motherboard. But when you're building yourself a $500 gaming PC, you gotta cut corners. And I think this is one that I'm pretty okay with cutting. The fact that I can confidently go out on Amazon, spend 30 minutes looking for parts, and come back with a $500 system that I can be very like happy with It's nice. Oh, you know what the problem's gonna be when everyone's running chatbots on their GPUs, and then that ruins pricing again? Premium Wraith Thermal Solution. I don't know how premium it is, but it's better than an Intel stock cooler. Goodbye, little CPU. I hope you enjoy your 2 seconds of air before you got brutally crushed. Boy, I love these noises so much. Oh no! Oh man.
Yeah, it's meant so kids couldn't open it.
That's uncalled for. Why is a blister pack? You ever heard the phrase, party in the front, naked in the back?
Oh my God.
I will say, while the WD Blue is a high quality, very reasonable SSD, it is quite blue, which does stand out a little bit in our case, I will say.
Again, for a $500 gaming PC, really complain?
No, I can't complain. Look, when you're building a budget gaming PC, the way you spend your money is incredibly important. A few dollars here and a few dollars there adds up really quickly. I think it's one of those things where when you're building and you get excited about your components, you can wildly overspend very quickly. But when you really keep yourself to a firm budget, it just means that, I don't want to say you're gonna have to corner cut, but you're gonna have to take some aggressive apexes on your way to the finish line. Alrighty, my friends, let's see if the Boson 5.0 wants to cooperate and work first try. Let's see if Boson 5.0 wants to work on the second try now that I've gotten that out of my system. Did I forget to plug it in?
Rookie mistake.
Here's the thing. I literally looked back here, and from this angle, it looked like it was on. All right, take two. Wow, that's actually like proper quiet. Literally with no side panels on, I could barely even hear that. Yes, yes, yes. Let's go. All right, so importantly, we are up and running. For this, I'm going to fast forward a little bit through the actual setup process. The main things to do here is anytime I build a system, I always like to make sure that the BIOS is fully up to date. So I'll go on the ASRock website, download the most recent BIOS for this board, flash that, and then I'll install Windows, and I'll be right back to see what the performance of our Boson 5.0 is like. I also should probably put the side panels back on.
And also, don't hit it. The metal is so thin.
Behold, my friends, the Boson 5.0. With a $500 budget, I'm really happy, especially with the performance of this system. I've already taken the time to tweak it, so now that we have Windows and all our drivers installed, I've changed the memory speed to the full XMP, as well as we've got resizable bar and able to give us just that little bit of extra performance that you get by using an AMD CPU and an AMD GPU. A very fair question is why I chose to use the Radeon 6500 XT. This is a budget GPU, which is pretty good for gaming, but is very lacking in pretty much every other category. Now, for a $500 budget, to me, this is the right move, because if you look at something like the NVIDIA equivalent, which would be a 1660 Super, mind you, this is a more powerful GPU, but it is over $100 more expensive. If you've got an extra $100, that's a better option, full stop. It's gonna be much better for streaming especially. But the downside here is that if you want to build a system in this kind of category, you have to make some choices. You have to make some sacrifices in some areas versus others. And for this, I am prioritizing gaming performance, not streaming, not everything else, because look, if I want to go with the NVIDIA GPU, I could do that. And then I'm going to be building in a cardboard box with 8 gigs of RAM, with a tiny little SSD. Like, I have to make so many other compromises with the system.
I couldn't afford a present this year, so I got you this box.
If you're gonna build yourself a $700 or $800 gaming PC, by all means go ahead. But once you start going down that slippery slope of getting outside your budget, you can find yourself spending an insane amount of money. Of course, there's definitely an argument that you could just buy yourself an Xbox Series S and get similar-ish performance. But the downside there is that you've got yourself the limitations of a console. This system is fully capable of playing pretty much every PC game out there. You might not be crushing it at 4K Ultra settings, but you're gonna be able to play almost anything. And I think that that's gonna actually stay true for quite a while. Because this is based on the same RDNA 2 architecture of the most recent series of consoles between PS5, Series X, and Series S, the fact that you've got ray tracing support, and the fact that this is actually broadly equivalent to the Xbox Series S when it comes to graphics horsepower. Sure, the GPU is a little bit smaller, so it's got fewer CUs to work with, but it is running at a much higher clock speed, meaning that as long as games are coming out for the Series S, odds are you'll probably be able to play them with the Boson 5.0. So to give you a little bit of an idea of the performance of this system, I'm gonna run a quick 3D Mark TimeSpy benchmark. Look at this! Look how nice this looks. And our score is $52.99. Pretty solid. So basically what we've got here is a system which punches above its weight when it comes to gaming and maybe leaves some streaming, some extra goodies on the table. Look, we're not gonna be streaming. We're not gonna be doing extra stuff. We're gamers. We game and we have enough RAM for Discord and Chrome. Okay, well no one has enough RAM for Chrome, but you know. Take what you can get. 10,351. So a very respectable score for the Ryzen 5 5500 CPU. It's funny because at this $500 budget, we've actually got two weird choices. Both our CPU and GPU are very unusual, but while they both have some limitations, I think those limitations actually work really well together. So this Ryzen 5 5500 was originally a laptop CPU that they just brought out for desktop use. So it has fewer PCI lanes for the graphics card, but guess what? Our GPU has fewer PCI lanes as well, so it just goes together like PB&J. Actually, it's pretty accurate. It's easy to make fun of Fortnite as a game that's just for kids, but the tech behind it is incredibly powerful. So recently there was a patch for the next-gen consoles, although it's not quite fully implemented on the Series S, that enables things like ray tracing, you've got things like Nanite, there's a lot of stuff here that will allow you to get a huge leap in visual quality. And so I'm gonna just try to turn it on. This is probably not going to work really well, but I'm just curious to see pushing the limits of the performance of this system, because what I've turned on here simply would not be working on a lower end NVIDIA GPU. Realistically, if this is what you're doing, you should be turning some of this stuff off, because again, this is a $500 gaming PC. But if I can get anywhere near a usable frame rate, this will actually be a pretty significant step up over what you would get on a Series S, and I will definitely take that. So, how about 8 FPS? I'm gonna maybe turn my settings down just a little bit. I got a little ambitious. We're gonna go to medium settings. Look at that! That's much more like it. Now we're up to 60 FPS. So this is just 1080p medium. That is so much better. I'm gonna just say straight up, Fortnite super duper playable at 1080p. Ah!
Austin, works.
I mean, oh, poop. Forza, Forza. Forza. I'm getting 90 FPS? Oh, what? Playing Forza Horizon 5, this is a game which is very well optimized for Xbox, of course, which also means it's really well optimized for this hardware, because again, what I've built here is not that weird. While I might be running a little bit low on video memory, it's fine, because guess what? It's running at 100 FPS. As I was saying, this game is very well optimized not only for the Xboxes, but importantly for the RDNA graphics and the Ryzen CPU, which means that I don't think you should expect 100 FPS in all games, but running at 1080p medium settings, this is 100% playable. I mean, 80, 90 FPS, even when I get into more busy areas, that's dope. It has been a long time since I've been able to, in good faith, recommend a $500 gaming PC build. But with this Boson 5.0, it checks all the boxes. If you want a 1080p gaming PC, if you want to get yourself into PC gaming in general, this is an excellent first step. Thank you very much for watching. Make sure to subscribe. Check out the PC tutorial if you want to know how to actually put the system together. And all the links I used will be in the description of this video.
I love you. You love me. Committing tax fraud is a felony.